And here we are today at historic Maple Grove Cemetery, indeed surrounded by 88,000 stories of eternal love. The Friends of Maple Grove Cemetery, basically a historical society with volunteers, more of whom have a great love for the past. Over the years, we have come across many wonderful love stories that were lost to time. But by the simple mention of their names and the retelling of their stories, they come back to life. Indeed, below us, carved in granite, directly below us, is an Egyptian proverb thousands of years old. To speak the name of the dead is to make them live again. We have found many beautiful stories of love here at Maple Grove, and they need to be remembered so that they will never be forgotten. From the story of a young Christian woman who protected and hid a young Jewish man during the horrors of World War II, they fell in love, married, came to America, raised a family, and now are resting here at Maple Grove side by side. Or the young teen couple who were about to marry but were separated by the division of the American Civil War. They would meet again 50 years later in a nursing home and fulfilled that vow and married. They too are here at Maple Grove, resting eternally. We even have the passionate story for the beloved pet Julia, a small black and white dog who was secretly buried here at Maple Grove in 1889, written upon her tiny white gravestone, "Julia, my only friend." The stories abound, and today we will examine a few, and with the help of Bill Gati and Wendy, they will enhance the passion of these love stories with music and song. Now, the first set is in honor of Florence and Frank Armstrong, and they're in your program. And Florence was from Woodhaven, was a school teacher, and she taught for 9 years. And she fell in love with the milkman. Frank was the milkman. And she gave up her job as teaching after 9 years at PS 58. And she married, and they moved to California, but their plot was here, and they came back, and they're buried side by side. As a school teacher, and I've taught for 39 years and going, and I found a wonderful little poem, a test for my teacher. I thought I would ask you a question today, teacher, because you are so good at asking me questions. Ready? 2 plus 2, 12 times 6. This question's not that easy. The 9th president of the United States, the capital of Texas. This question's cheesier. Get ready now and study hard to get a good grade on your report card. Here comes the question. Take your time. Will you be my Valentine? I'll be back. We have Bill Gati. And
would have enjoyed. So it's imperative that as we're playing, you read the program. Mm-hmm. If you don't have reading glasses, how many don't have reading glasses? A couple of you. All right. Well, you don't count because you already know. I want to also thank Wendy Luck for coming out here. It's really a privilege and an honor to be playing with such a wonderful musician. You're welcome. And you know, I'm sure you didn't come here to hear me talk, so why don't I just sit down and start playing the piano for you?
Thank you. Thank you.
interesting because my father's actually encrypted all the way in one of those tombs over there. So he's actually one of the residents of the cemetery. And I feel his presence over here. But it's really amazing. And if it wasn't for him, then I wouldn't even be playing with him. Because I wanted to be a tennis player. We'd be seeing at the U.S. Open. Take your time. We're not in a hurry. We have all day. It's nice seeing my friends from the Melodians here. Raise your hand, Melodians. There you are.
that they will perform music for is Elma and George Stebbins. Now, George, his senior program, was a prolific gospel hymn writer, writing over 1,500 gospel songs. He's buried here, and he was born in 1846. And Elma and George were missionaries, and they went through all different parts of the Orient, visiting India and the Far East back in the late 1800s. And they traveled with their young son, and they went on to Egypt, Palestine, Naples, Rome, Florence, Paris, and London. Now, for years, George was in constant demand to sing. He was also a singer at conventions and meetings. Now, this leads to a very famous story on how his voice may have been the first ever recorded by Thomas Edison phonograph. It begins with his friend Philip Paul Bliss, also a well-known teacher, evangelist, and soloist who wrote many hymns. And on December 29, 1876, Bliss and his wife Lucy were on a train to Pennsylvania to attend a convention. As their train was crossing over an icy river in Ohio, the bridge suddenly gave way, and all the train cars fell into the freezing water. Bliss escaped through a window, only to find that his beloved Lucy had somehow been left behind in the wreckage. Although he had been advised against it, Bliss headed back into the fire, saying, "If I cannot save her, I will perish with her." Both passed. Among Bliss's belongings were the lyrics to "I Will Sing of My Redeemer." The following year, in 1877, the lyrics were set to music and became very popular, and George was asked to sing it often. During a singing tour in New England, an Edison phonograph was presented and may have been the first recorded sound by a human.
Wow.
And P.S., they were married into another musician. A great-granddaughter married into the family of John Philip Sousa.
Thank you.
Showed the light on dark tenements, vice centers, lax police administration, and other areas of civil neglect. He also wrote The Making of American, and Elizabeth contributed one chapter of the book on how they met and eventually married. She supported her husband in many of his works, and they would often invite children from different settlement homes into their home for a day in the country. In 1900, Clara, their daughter, was married in the Church of the Resurrection on Lefferts Boulevard, and President Theodore Roosevelt escorted Elizabeth down the aisle. Jacob and Elizabeth celebrated their civil wedding anniversary in 1901, and the King of Denmark bestowed on them the title of Sir Jacob and Lady Elizabeth, honorary titles that they refused to use, as he said, in America, we have no royalty. Jacob affectionately called his wife Elizabeth his little lamb and placed a small statue of the lamb upon her gravestone when she passed. And a memorial window, stained glass window, was erected in the Church of Resurrection depicting a good shepherd holding a little lamb. He also planted two magnificent beech trees that are standing today at her grave, and they've been designated Great Historic Trees of New York City. There is a letter that was sent to him upon Elizabeth's passing, and it starts, "Beloved friend, in the terrible, elemental griefs, no one, no matter how close, can give any real comfort to you. All I can say is what you know, my dear friend, with a bruised and aching heart. You know how my wife and I loved your dear Elizabeth, who has gone before us. You know how we loved her. You know how we think of her, how we feel for your crushing calamity. The life of you two was an ideal life. Later on, not now, you will be able to recognize what a wealth of precious memories you are left with. You and I, friend, are now in the range of the rifle pits, and if we live, sorrows like this must fall upon us. May the unseen powers be with you as you now walk in shadow. Ever your friend, Theodore Roosevelt, President of the United States."
Wendy and I will be singing, and we'd like everybody to join us, okay? like to learn it? Okay, so the words are very simple. And it's also all right, try and repeat after me. 'Tis a gift to be simple, 'tis a gift to be free.
It's a gift to
come down to me where you want to be.
refreshments and desserts and wine and cheese. So, and meet Bill and Wendy down there. They'll be performing. I heard they'll play some of the flute downstairs as well for us while we're. We'll be serenaded, basically. Look at your programs. Look at your programs. Turn to the back. If you see our tree logo and it has one little heart hanging from it, raise your hand. There you go. If you have the tree with two little hearts, two little hearts over here. Two little hearts. And if you have three hearts hanging on the tree, up there, those are the big ones. There should be one little butterfly. You have two butterflies. Two. And three butterflies. There you go. Three butterflies. Still looking for the one butterfly. The next couple, and there's two couples left, is Rosina and Joseph Levine. Now, Rosina was born in Russia in 1880 and grew up in Moscow and loved music and joined the Imperial Music Conservatory of Moscow. As a young student, she had a tutor a few years older than her, and that was Joseph. And they fell in love, and upon her graduation, they married. Upon her graduation, she won a gold medal from the Moscow Conservatory for her talent on piano. So did her husband, Joseph. And she says she gave up her ambitions for a musical career, even though she won the gold medal, and devoted her life as a wife to Joseph and to concentrate on his career as a pianist. Quote, I gave up my ambitions of a musical career and devoted my life to be his wife and to concentrate on his career as a pianist. I will never regret it. His hands played the notes that was the only difference. I knew every note, and I felt as if I had played 1,000 concerts. After World War I, they moved to, before World War I, they moved to Berlin, Germany, and because of their Jewish descent, encountered many discriminations. They moved to the United States at the end of the war and moved to Kew Gardens, and they built a house not too far from here, and they raised their children. They both were one of the earliest faculty of the Juilliard School and ended in 1924. They often addressed her as Madam, or her other nickname, the Little Empress. This call. Right. Joseph passed in 1944, and his wake was held at the Juilliard School. After Joseph's death, I remained at Juilliard, but she started her own musical career and played a number of solo concerts. She performed a concert at the New York Philharmonic at the age of 82 in 1963. One of her most famous Juilliard students was Van Cliburn, and she taught many other famous pianists from all over the world. She encouraged a young pianist, one of her students, who had an ear for composing, and encouraged him to continue with his composing, and that was, of course, the Academy Award winner, John Williams. And we have this little email that was sent to us 10 years ago when she celebrated her 130th anniversary, her birthday. Madame Rosina Levine is a legendary figure in the musical in classical music. After the sudden loss of her husband, Madame Levine's deep grief was transformed into a strength of communicating to her many students of her love for the arts of great music. God blessed her with youthful vitality, a long life, multiplicity of friends and admirers, and a rich musical fulfillment. I join her countless admirers with my personal respect, admiration, and affection for this great lady, Van Cliburn. Hmm.
celebration of.
Before I start, I just want to make like a short introduction about this that's personal to me. I have the privilege of going to Juilliard under, I didn't study with her obviously because she was before my time, but her technique stayed within the Juilliard walls. And she wrote a book about piano forte technique with her husband. And it personally changed my life, the way I play. And I want to share with you guys a very important secret of how to play piano, according to Josephine Levine. How many of you are pianists? Raise your hand. How many of you know how many keys are on a piano? All right, that's it.
Yeah.
Okay. So most pianists play like this. Do your pianist play like that? Does it sound good?
No. It sounds tinny.
Exactly. So she has a technique, and she taught this to all her students, and she wrote a book about it. It's called a brush stroke. The brush stroke. And what it is instead of playing the piano like this, you're brushing the keys. You're brushing the keys with your finger. Very, very difficult technique because you have to have strong fingers, first of all. But when you play fast, brushing the piano is not that easy. So I'll demonstrate one way of playing without brushing. And this is with brushing. So with that in mind, I'd like you to listen to the following selections. And this is basically the kind of music that she would be teaching at Juilliard. Okay, anyway, here we go. that all these pieces are from the Romantic era, which ties into Valentine's Day. Mm-hmm. And the next one is one of my favorites. Debussy is absolutely amazing, and this is one of my favorite Debussy pieces.
It's a shame that he's in
She's beautiful. She has a beautiful, beautiful bouquet. Smells wonderful. But if you touch her the wrong way, her thorns will really hurt. I'm not kidding.
Thank you.
something else, and this is, I don't think it's ever been played at the cemetery, but I thought it might be appropriate to at least give you an idea of what Tchaikovsky's Piano Concerto number 1 sounds like. And why did I pick that? Does anybody know? Somebody surely must know why I picked Tchaikovsky's Piano Concerto number 1.
Because it was number 1. And you're number 1.
Good one.
I'm sure Carl knows why. All right, anyway. Tchaikovsky's Piano Concerto number 1 was Van Cliburn's favorite piece. And who was Van Cliburn? He was Levine's student. He also won the Tchaikovsky piano competition in Moscow. And why is that so important?
It was the Cold War. Was he an American?
Cold War. And he was the first American pianist. Could you just say it? No. No, she's shy. First American pianist to win the Tchaikovsky piano competition. So, please, I don't have the Queen's Symphony Orchestra here, so I'm going to play the piano part and the orchestra part, and I'm just doing a little bit so you can hear it. I got to have some water. Not even.
First sight, and they did marry, and they and they formed a dance group called Martin and Fabrini. And for 15 years, they performed in stock theater, musical comedy, and vaudeville. They even played at the Palace. Right. But he had, as his dancing career ended, he had another talent. He was quite a well-known artist, and he drew many comical figures for a number of variety magazines. And one of his, and he created a cartoon character for a comic strip for the daily papers. And it was based on his wife, Edith, and it was Winnie Winkle. You remember Winnie Winkle? On the age of Dandy and Dick Tracy, the daily newspaper comic strips. And it debuted in September 1920. And Winnie Winkle was the first female depicted as the breadwinner of the family. By 1939, it was in 125 newspapers across America and even in Europe, and it was a circulation of 8.5 million. The title was, and it lasted for, and had a 76-year run. Edith and Michael are buried here at Maple Grove Cemetery. After the last musical part, please, I invite you to come down to our reception and our art exhibit downstairs, and I'll talk about that at the end. Thank you.
Thank you.
died far too young. But I will see how we can have it here for young.
Thank you.
Thank you, Wendy. We have a wonderful reception that Bill and Wendy will be at downstairs. Two art local artists, we have an exhibit of their work. We're the only cemetery in the world that has a concert hall and this huge cemetery piano. But we have an art gallery downstairs. So we have homemade treats that were company that we ordered from. So all I ask, and this is something since the start of our new season, I'm going to wear my discipline hat. Don't leave cups on the floor. If a grape rolls down, please pick it up, because then also it's slipping on the grape. We have six garbage bins downstairs. Please enjoy. We have red and white wine, cheese, crackers, and assorted desserts. Thank you.